Have them going down the field 4 or 5 times. You may only get a possession once a half. We'd beat people by 6 points or 7 points or 14 points. I mean, it would just be just barely, but hold on to that ball, pound it down the field, and, you know, you got the possession of it. And we weren't that good, but I'll tell you, the difference was we had a better attitude. And there is something about individuals that just want to serve the Lord, just want to please God, just want to see Him work, and they have an enthusiasm that makes them able to accomplish things that are far beyond their ability, and not only are beyond their ability, but that sets them apart and allows them to be usable. You give me a Sunday school class of teachable people, and I don't care if they have an IQ of 20, and they'll accomplish more for the Lord than a whole Sunday school class full of people that have an IQ of 150 or 160. And God is not impressed, my friend, with ability of ours, because God has all the ability in the world. Now I want to talk about this matter of giving. The Apostle Paul mentions in 2 Corinthians 8 and verse 1, he says, moreover, and he's going, which means he's going to move to a different topic. He's going to talk about something different. He said, moreover, brethren, we do you to wit, in other words, we want you to be aware of, we want you to know, of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. Paul said, I want you to know about these churches over in Macedonia and about God's grace to them. In other words, there's something about the churches at Macedonia that set them apart and made them remarkable in such a way that they were used as a good illustration. And let me point out to you the thing that set them apart in this passage of Scripture. If you look down to verse 7, you will see that Paul is again referring to the church at Corinth. And he says, therefore, as he said, I sent Titus to teach you about the thing that sets Macedonia apart. But he says, therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith, he says, your ability, church at Corinth, to trust God for things, abundant. I mean, it's better than average. Plenty, just, it's excellent. Yeah, your ability in utterance. What is utterance? Well, it's articulating Bible truth. In other words, this church at Corinth had no trouble at all telling people about Jesus Christ. They were not said, they were not told, hey, you're Secret Service Christians. No, this is your, there's no problem with your desire and your ability to preach the gospel. He says, and acknowledge. He says, you know, I'm not going to get after you guys for being babes in Christ. We had gotten after them in 1 Corinthians, and now they've corrected that, and they're growing. And so he says, no problem with knowledge. He says, in all diligence. He says, you're not lazy. You're not sluggardly. You're not, as we learned in Titus today, slow bellies. He says, you have all, you're diligent. And in your love toward us, love to us. And he says, now since you abound in all these things, see that ye abound in this grace also. What grace is this? Well, it's a thing that set Macedonia apart from the other churches, and that is the grace of giving. Now, to talk about the grace of giving, I think we could probably all assume the same thing and get to the same place, but let's define what grace is in this context. Grace is God's ability. Grace is when we have been given grace, it's something that does not find its power or its source in us. Grace, in the context of salvation, is God doing for us what we could not do. And folks have defined it many ways. But grace is the ability to, for us to be what we could not be, to accomplish what we could not. Grace has the ability of outside. In other words, power that comes from without, not from within. Now, the superstitious, superficial church today talks about, you know, the power within. Grace is not power within. It is power from outside. It is power that does not find its source in us. And I want to point out something to you, Christian, today, that the Bible teaches that if a church were to have all of these abilities, the ability of utterance, which I think is incredibly important, the ability of knowledge, ability of faith, and of diligence. And if we had all of these characteristics, that there would be something that we could learn about grace. And it'd be grace-giving. And so we find grace-giving is taught here in 2 Corinthians 8. I've introduced this to Todd. He's taking a very long time. And so let's try to define, if you will, what grace-giving was. First of all, it was something that Macedonia did in order for things to be equal in the other churches. In other words, the folks at Macedonia gave to supply the needs of others. And they did so, the Bible says, willingly. Their attitude was, oh, we want to do this. But they did so in such a way that it made them exemplary. You know, I've been impressed, and I don't preach very much about what people ought to give or how they ought to give, but I've been impressed that if we're going to please God, our church ought to be a giving church. It ought to be a giving church. And by that I mean not just accumulating. There are accumulating churches and there's giving churches. But we ought to, if we want to please God, to understand this matter of grace. Now, something about this grace I want to point out to you is, first of all, if its source is God, then it's something we can do. If the ability to give grace-giving is God's ability, then it's something that we can do. Have you ever wanted to do something, but you didn't because you couldn't? Have you ever had somebody ask you for something? Probably the thing that people ask me for the most that I can't give is time. Sometimes folks will want to do something. I know other preachers. And a lot of times they'll say, Pastor Price, do you think you could come and... And I have to say, I would love to. I want to, but I can't because I don't have the time. And your time just is gone so quickly, and sometimes you just don't have it to give. Now, I understand you can give grace-giving of your time as well as grace-giving. But the thing I want to point out to you is that this kind of giving has nothing to do with what you have. This kind of giving has nothing to do with what you have. And hence, I would say to you that though I believe that the Old Testament certainly teaches a tithe in the New Testament is very much a scriptural concept. Jesus applauded or lauded the Pharisees for giving tithes so specifically that they tithed of their herbs. And so it is a concept that's in the New Testament. This is not an abolishing of that concept. But friend, I have to say to you that in order to see God abound and God do great things, in order for us to have a place and a time in our life when we do more than just what is required, and we begin to see God do things that are far beyond man's ability, we have got to get beyond doing what man can do and do things by grace. And Paul points out to the church here that there are several things that happen as a result of this. And I just want to point those out to you this morning. First of all, he says in verse 6, he said, of chapter 9, by the way, he says, this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. A year ago, we did a Sunday school class on biblical stewardship, and the project for the class was to go through the book of Proverbs and to write down everything that had to do with finances or resources to do with stewardship. And I, of course, if I'm going to assign my class to do the project, needed to do the project myself. And one of the things that really stood out to me was how much there is a promise in the Scripture of blessing with regard to faithfulness and giving. And if you'll do a study in the book of Proverbs, you just find out a person who's faithful in the area of finances, God blesses them. And that blessing is not, and by the way, I believe this, I don't think finances are a good barometer for blessing. Would you agree with that? In other words, somebody comes to you and says, God's really blessing them, and then proceeds to tell you about finances. I'll be honest with you, usually my thought of it is, there's more to God's blessing than that. Health and wealth can be a part of God's blessing, but my friend, the absence of health and the absence of wealth can also be a part of God's blessing. I've found that to be true and have seen it many times, not only by personal experience, but by studying the Scripture. And sometimes what you don't have is better than what you do. I was talking, I hope you wouldn't mind this, but I was speaking with Brother Earl this week, and he was talking.